Malcom, everyone. Welcome to our first lecture of Describe Islam Week. So today we're starting off with a talk on Malcolm X. Before that, Osman's going to do a presentation. So, what do you think?
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والضحى والليل إذا سجى ما ودعك ربك وما قلى وللآخرة خير لك من الأولى ولسوف يعطيك ربك فترضى ألم يجدك يتيما فآوى ووجدك ضالا فهدى ووجدك عائلا فأغنى فأما اليتيم فلا تقهر وأما السائل فلا تنهر وأما بنعمة ربك فحدث صدق الله العظيم.
So, I'll just introduce the speaker today, Dr. Amir Saeed. There's a picture of him, and we have him in the flesh as well. So, Amir Saeed is a senior lecturer in the Department of Media and Cultural Studies at the University of Sunderland. His research interests are in race, ethnicity, and media power, whilst having written numerous books, chapters, and journal articles, including Malcolm X and British Muslims, Personal Reflection, as well as Between Marx and Muhammed, Class Politics, and British Muslims, and many, many more. We're actually really lucky to have Amir Saeed today. He's a pretty much expert in his field, and I'm sure today is going to be pretty fantastic. Same time tomorrow is our next talk. We have calligraphy in the marquee, 11 till 3, calligraphy workshop, delivered by the Calligraphy Society. And our talk for tomorrow is Sheikh Ahmed Babika, Spirituality of the Prophet, Soul Food. And then there's Thursday, Friday, and that's it. So I'm going to hand over now.
Assalamu alaikum. My name's Amir. As the brother said there, I'm a senior lecturer in Media and Cultural Studies at the University of Sunderland, which is in the northeast of England. As you can tell from my accent, I'm actually from even further north. Okay, I'm from, well, I was born in Pakistan, but I've lived all my life in Scotland, okay, until I moved out to England about 10 or 12 years ago, right, okay. My talks is on my hero, Malik al-Shabazz, brother minister, Malcolm X, right, okay. But I spent the whole weekend doing this talk, and I had lots of like embedded videos and everything else, and I even had music, and Muhammad Ali was there as well. And I've been contacting the brother there all day. I'm sure he switched his phone off, because I always get nervous before I talk. I wanted to be here about an hour ago so I could get everything set up to make sure it worked, because I knew what was going to happen. And lo and behold, you know, the FBI and the Israeli intelligence services have managed it. They've managed to, what you call, sabotage my talk. Right, okay, so I'm going to be running around here now, right, and hopefully it's going to work. And but I do apologise if it doesn't flow as well as it should. If you do want the talk in its entirety, you're more than welcome to email me, right, okay. And I was saying to the brother, right, okay, apparently about 2 years ago I actually took part in a documentary on the Islam channel about Malcolm X. And people can email me, and I'll get them a copy of that of that documentary, and there's lots of other people there talking about Brother Malcolm as well, right? Okay. Also, if you do go onto my university homepage, you'll see that I've got a number of different articles all around the idea of racism, Islamophobia, etc. Right? If you are wanting any of those articles, please email me, right? Okay, and I'll send you the articles for nothing, right? Okay, you won't have to pay, honestly, right? Okay, I'll send you them all for nothing, right? Okay, and Malcolm X used to say, Brother Malcolm used to say, you know, you have to organise, you have to prepare, right? Okay, and this is a prime example of us not preparing well. And I mean us collectively, right, okay? I have just finished a paper, right, okay, which is going to be published in the Journal of War and Cultural Studies on the Israeli propaganda machine, okay? And I argue in that paper that the reason that what you call the Israelis managed to garner so much sympathy for their onslaughts in Gaza or whatever is because they have a well-slicked PR machine, a public relations machine, a well-slicked media. And that is why Brother Malcolm X, when he was alive, one of the first things that he did when he joined the Nation of Islam was start his own newspaper called Muhammad Speaks, because he said we have to control our own representation, right? Okay, so that's me. I'm sorry, I'm having a bit of a rant because I spent Saturday and Sunday trying to get his paper prepared, and it hasn't worked as well as I was hoping it to work. Right now. Previous research on Malcolm X, right, has taken, I would say, the kind of fallen approaches about the Brother Minister. Okay, sometimes, mostly, people look at his racial politics and the idea of what's called black nationalism. So, it's the idea that he was black first, and that's all that mattered. That he was a black nationalist, and that's all that mattered. Other research has taken what's called a very leftist approach. And by that I mean, you've had people who've claimed that Malcolm X said things like, capitalism breeds racism. Hence, Brother Malcolm was turning towards becoming a socialist, etc. Right? Some people have even looked upon what's called a Freudian approach and have tried to analyse Malcolm X from a psychological approach, etc. Right, and how his identity changed, has he progressed? Right, others have looked at all of these approaches, though, have talked about the racist structure in the USA. However, and you know, this is I remember doing a talk on Malcolm X in Trinidad and Tobago. It was a conference. It was actually in Black Power, and it was in September of last year. I did this conference, right, and everyone was talking about the first approach or the second approach. And I said, look, the Brother Minister died in 1965. 1960, the sort of Black Panther Party were created in 1966. Dr. Martin Luther King died in 1968. 1965, he was 39 years old. Yes, he was. She's arguing with me. I'm a doctor, please be quiet. Okay, right. He was only 39 years old when the brother was killed. 39, right, okay. And what people have failed to realise is the transformation Malcolm X had from in his last 6 or 7 months of his life. So they ignored the religious underpinnings of his life, right. And this, I think, is really, really sad, because we don't know how Malcolm's politics and social outlook would have developed. You know what I mean? Because he was moving that fast. I think the brother was ahead of his time. I really, really do. Everything which is happening in the world today, the brother actually, what you call, prophesied. You know, he talked about this was what was going to happen. Right, now, my first recollection of Malcolm X, right, was, I'm 43 years old, right, okay, and I can remember in the late 1970s, right, okay, when I was growing up in Scotland, whenever we got racist abuse, my mum and dad would say to me, Amir, don't fight back, just turn the other cheek, bow your head if somebody calls you this, that and the next thing. Just, and you know, and me and my brothers would go, yeah, well, that's what we're going to do, no problem, yeah. And then once we were out in the street, you know, we were like, oh, that's not happening. That is not happening, you know what I mean? And we actually, in my opinion, stood up for our beliefs. My first recollection of Malcolm X, right, his name getting mentioned, it was nothing to do with politics. It was because of somebody else, right? And I was hoping this would have flowed right in to the top, but it hasn't. It was because of...
Connected with his body, his hands, his arms, his head, all together. He never danced like that again. And that was just something to behold. He had a ball that night, and he was a happy character. The ring was his domain, his kingdom. When that bell rings, he would really take over.
Was Ali's best fight ever. I mean, he made me watch this so many mistakes. No one in the history of boxing can have beaten Ali ever.
Okay, so why have I mentioned Muhammad Ali? Because I can remember growing up, right, in the mid-1970s, and when the Muhammad Ali fight came on, our whole family went crazy. You know, we'd make samosas and pakora and lovely kind of nice food and all that. And my mum, who didn't even like sport, but when Muhammad Ali came on, everything had to stop. You know what I mean? It all stopped, because it wasn't just because it was Muhammad Ali. He was a Muslim. Fighting a black Muslim. So out in the street, we get called racist names. But Ali, Muhammad Ali, he gave us respect, because then we could turn round and go, did you watch the Muhammad Ali fight yesterday? Yeah, did you see that Muslim? He's just like me. And you were thinking he's great, and look how great he was. Wasn't he beautiful? Wasn't he handsome? He was just gorgeous, wasn't he? And look at you. You're Scottish. You're rubbish. Okay. And that's what I mean. Was it Malcolm, Ali's conversion to the Islam or to the Nation of Islam? And I know that I'll be talking about the Nation of Islam and Sunni Islam later on, okay? But that's what introduced us to Malcolm X, you know? So we started reading more about Brother Malcolm, and we loved his idea of any means necessary, no sellout. Don't turn the other cheek, you know. Basically, we liked that. It was a very naive understanding of the brother minister, because his politics is much more than that. But we thought, we're going to fight back if somebody calls us names. Okay, so here was, in our opinion, a black man who was not scared and dared challenge the white, racist, colonialist. Malcolm gave us pride and a positive self-esteem. That's really important. A positive self-esteem. I'll be talking about that later on. Okay. By reading Malcolm's speeches, my brothers and I had a strong affinity with the racism suffered by black Americans and also other colonised people around the globe. In short, Malcolm gave us an internationalist outlook on our politics and understanding of racism and capitalism. And I've highlighted that in bold, because I think that is still the problem with too many people around the world. They look at their own, what's happening to their own so-called people, in isolation, without realising the wider circumstances. For example, In 2003, I had a chapter published in a book called Anti-Capitalist Britain, where I spoke to young British Muslims about how they felt at 9/11. And a lot of these, you know, and a lot of these young British Muslims were saying that, this is a war on Islam, this is a war on Islam. You know, George Bush and Tony Blair at the time were just doing everything they can to get. And I was going, well, are you sure? What about what's happening to Hugo Chavez in Venezuela? Okay, what about... And they were like, oh, that's nothing to do with us. I'm going, it has. If you think about the international politics of this, rather than just the sort of racial or religious politics. And that's why, I mean, remember, in 1964, in the early 1960s, Brother Malcolm was talking about Palestine. Nowadays, we have a black man in the White House who's scared to mention that name, Palestine. He's scared to mention it. Right, in the early 1990s, he was talking about Palestine. An African-American talking about Middle East people. He was talking about China. He was talking about the Congo. He was talking about Pakistan, Brother Malcolm. He was talking about all these different things. It wasn't just, oh, I better just talk about African-Americans and nothing else. You know what I mean? And there's a very good speech that Brother Malcolm gave, and he said that African-Americans have got to realise that their problem is not a problem of civil rights, it's a problem of human rights. So it's not a problem about civil America, it's about what we regard as a human internationally. And that's why, one of the reasons why I had a strong affinity with Brother Malcolm. Now, in 1965, right, Brother Malcolm made was talking about this speech. I might point to out here, colonialism or imperialism is not just something that's just part of, confined to England or France, or etc., etc. It's part of the international power structure. This international power structure is used to suppress the masses of dark-skinned people all across the globe. Okay. Likewise, a very famous anti-imperialist at the time, an Algerian writer, I think, Franz Fanon, talked about, and it's fact, Europe's well-being and progress was built upon the sweat, corpses of blacks, Arabs, Indians and Asians. That is a fact. Okay, last week I showed my 11-3 race module. It's about 100 white people, and it is about 100 white people. Okay, and I showed them about what happened in the Congo. Okay, with King Leopold, right, and they were disgusted, but they never knew anything about it. My next clip, I showed them what happened when the Spanish landed in South America and what they did to the Native Americans. What Franz Fanon was saying here is an absolute fact. The second thing, now look at Malcolm X talking in 1965. What's he talking about? He hasn't mentioned it, but he's talking about globalisation. Think about globalisation. Think about the WTO and the IMF, the World Trade Organization, the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank. One of the other videos that I show to my 11-3 race module is of people in Pakistan, so-called peasants, and I'm putting that in inverted commas, right? And they know all about the WTO and the IMF. And I ask my students, how come you don't know about that? And they always say, well, look, what happens, the World Bank, the WTO and IMF give loans to corrupt dictators, and these corrupt dictators keep the money and then cut services in their country. That's called globalisation. This is what Malcolm X is talking about. Okay, it's not about one country. It's about the whole structure. Okay, it's institutional racism, for want of a better, description. Okay, and this is Malcolm X talking about this in 1965. Now, I lecture on globalisation. I lecture on what we mean by globalisation, what we mean by imperialism, and I've never ever seen any academic mentioning Brother Malcolm and his speeches there. And he's talking about it 46 years ago. Now, one of the things which I love about the brother, right, is, in my opinion, and if you haven't read the book yet, a book came out last year called Malcolm X, A Life of Reinvention by an American academic called Manning Marable, who's sadly passed away now. Right, he points out that Malcolm X personified resistance to injustice, and he was a revolutionary, not just in name, but also in thought and action. You know, and this was I remember reading that quote from Manning Marable and thinking about Malcolm X's speech where he talked about like human rights, not civil rights. And then obviously, I'm sure most of you are familiar with the following quote from the Holy Quran. And I just thought, here was somebody trying to say that injustice is wrong. And in my opinion, maybe you people might disagree, but I really thought this is what we're told to live our life by, and this is what the man tried to do. Now, why do we have to understand Malcolm X so long after he sort of died? Right, and Michael Dyson basically summarises it perfectly in a book called Making Malcolm. He basically says that he's one of the key figures of the 20th century, and I'll try to explain that. Hence, his life and thought is crucial to what you call future generations, and it deserves constant attention, re-attention, etc. It deserves that. We're always told to read about Karl Marx or Durkheim or Freud, etc. Very rarely in the social sciences are we told, read Brother Malcolm, okay? Unless, of course, you're doing MA modules, where I tell everybody you have to buy the autobiography of Malcolm X, or they'll fail the module. Most of them end up failing the module. Right, so if you think of Malcolm's life story, right, it is the classical so-called alternative American dream. The American dream, if you believe in it, is meant to be anyone from the sort of log house can make it to the White House, i.e. anyone who is rich or poor can make it. It doesn't matter, because America is the land of the free and the home of the brave, and opportunity is just with every step that you take. Okay, well, if you look at Brother Malcolm's life story, that's not the case. His father was killed at 6. His mother was put into care. Right. He embarked on a life of petty crime, and then whilst incarcerated, he was reached by the message of the Nation of Islam, and his life takes this other kind of turn, basically. Now, I think, if you think of that, right, okay, this happens, if you analyse this from an academic perspective, right, this actually happens to minority people more so than so-called majority people. The chances are, if you are black, you're more likely to be diagnosed with schizophrenia, that's a fact. Okay, psychiatrists have mentioned that mental health, people who examine mental health have basically said that. Look what happened to Louise, Malcolm X's mum. Look what, in America at the time, and now, if you're black, you're still going to be the subject of, you're more likely to be the subject of some sort of violent death than white people, and that is a fact. So all this basically happens. Now, so if you think of Malcolm X and his identity is always changing as he encounters new knowledge. Now, if you think about the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, right, this is the duty of every single Muslim, is to always gain knowledge all the time. So Malcolm's knowledge is always changing. He has what you could consider a slave mentality at the start. He then becomes Detroit Red, a hustler. Then he becomes Malcolm X, the Nation of a member of the Nation of Islam. And eventually he becomes Malik El-Shabazz, and a Muslim. Or the epitome of pan-Africanism. You know, and in my opinion, what Malcolm, if you look at Malcolm X's life, it's the idea that showed that black people are no longer invisible, they're now visible. They started to make a saying in the 1960s. Now, just stepping back a bit, right, this idea of Islam in America. Now, even nowadays, right, people are shocked with that. Think about the sort of recent protests about the so-called Ground Zero Mosque. Oh, Islam is un-American, etc., or it's un-British, etc., etc. But let's, I mean, if you go back, Gomez, in a great book, talks about how since the slave trade began, there's been a Muslim presence in America. And mainly Muslims from West Africa who were kidnapped as slaves, you know, continue to practice their faith there, okay? And Gomez also points out in some larger plantations, they even built mosques. Okay, well, obviously mosques that were hidden from the sort of the master. But there's always been a presence of Islam in the USA. However, Malcolm X is, now I put this in bold, this is from a book by a guy called William Vandenberg called New Day in Babylon. And these, to me, are, in my opinion, encapsulate what Brother Malcolm basically meant. Right, okay. He is the most important figure in the liberation of blacks worldwide. He is the reference point, okay, and the spiritual advisor. And what Malcolm X did, right, was that he was changing identities all the time, changing the N into black men into a black nation into black power into equality, into world equality, right, okay. So what does that basically mean, right, okay? Well, if you think of that quote there, right, okay, what Malcolm X was basically, Malcolm X used to always say to people, why do you call yourself a Negro? Why do you call yourself a Negro? And he always used the term so-called Negro, the so-called Negro. And then he'd say, the word Negro is a Victorian anthropological term, which basically could mean dead. Okay? So if you accept that term, you're saying that I have no history, I am dead, my culture has no history. So he said, don't accept that term. Accept the term African or even black. Now, what's wrong with the term black? What's wrong with that term? Now, think about it. He's talking about, my brother Malcolm is talking about in the late 1950s and in the early 1960s. Now, I might show a clip of Muhammad Ali again. So when Muhammad Ali is turning around early 1960s and saying, I'm black and I'm beautiful. Now, these days, that it doesn't really mean a lot, right? But those days, that was a profound statement, okay? If you've seen the film Malcolm X by Denzel Washington, there's a great scene in it where Malcolm X gets the sort of dictionary and he says, black, what does it mean? Bad. Devoid of all character. Negative. Black sheep. All the negative connotations. And he says, what does white mean? Innocent, pure, etc., etc. So he's changing that mindset. So, I mean, the best way to think about this, right, is if you went up to a black man in America in 1960, and if you were being polite, you'd say he's a Negro. Okay? By 1968, okay, you wouldn't say that. You'd say he's either black or African-American. So this was a change. It was a psychic conversion. Right, now, it wasn't just effects on the black community, right? Now, if you look at 1960s politics, right, that's what William Vandenberg's book basically says, right? What happened after the 1960s? From in the mid-1960s, you had what was called the Civil Rights Movement, right? Where people like Martin Luther King, etc., stood up and said, I have a dream. Then what happens in 1966? You have people inspired by Brother Malcolm. Groups like the sort of Black Panther Party saying, I'm no longer going to turn the other cheek. You know what I mean? I'm going to use the auspices of Malcolm X and take that a stage further. Right, okay. Then, the Black Panthers, they inspired the civil rights of women, believe it or not, the women's movement becomes more apparent in the 1960s. Even the gay movement becomes more apparent in the 1960s. Okay? The anti-war movement becomes more apparent in the 1960s. And all of this takes its cue from the idea of black civil rights, which was inspired by Malcolm X. So, for example, if you think of somebody like Muhammad Ali, look at how Muhammad Ali is talking here, if this works. Him too seriously, you know, he's just having a laugh. Then he changes his name to Muhammad Ali. I've got a great clip where he says Muhammad means most high, Ali means worthy of all praises. Right, in fact, one of my articles I actually have written is called Worthy of All Praises, and he talks about what when he encounters the Nation of Islam, what happened to his consciousness. So think about his speeches then. He's talking about segregation and racism. Now, here's a sports star doing that, a sports star in the mid-1960s. Now, and I find it quite astonishing that Muhammad Ali was not shot dead. Now, I know that this sounds crazy, because right now, you go to America and you say Muhammad Ali and everyone goes, oh yeah, wonderful, great. But he was hated in the 1960s, actually hated. People called him a Benedict Arnold, which, i.e. an American traitor. That's what they called him in the USA. Remember, Muhammad Ali was stripped from fighting from 1964 to 1967 because he refused to go to Vietnam. Okay, all of this, all of this things basically happened. Now, the reason this happened, right, and I don't have probably time to show you, right, but I can give you the clip, was Muhammad Ali met Malcolm X, right? Okay, and Malcolm X thought of Muhammad Ali as his little brother. Okay, and he tried to support him and help him, and he gave him guidance. And yes, Muhammad Ali joined the Nation of Islam. Okay, now I know the Nation of Islam is not an orthodox Islamic group. Okay, and I appreciate that, right? But having said that, I think it had a role in society in America in the 1950s and 60s. I think it had a role. The reason I think it had a role is because, as Muhammad Ali said there, people were called clay in America. Okay, people didn't know what their history was, right? And here was an organisation, okay, which tried to say, look, black people have a history, black people have a culture, black people have a tradition. Okay, black people even had a religion before Christianity. Okay, right, before there were Christians in America. Right, and I can remember reading something, I think it was Malcolm X talking about the Nation of Islam after he'd left. And to me, this was the greatest of the guy, of Malcolm X. He didn't really criticise Elijah Muhammad or the Nation of Islam or Minister Louis Farrakhan. And what Malcolm X said, right, okay, it was that if you have a caged tiger, if you've got a tiger which you have kept in a room all of its life, this tiger has never seen outside. If you show that tiger a back garden, he'll think it's a jungle. That's what Malcolm X said. And what Malcolm X said, what he meant by that was black people did not know Islam because it'd been stolen from them. It'd been taken away from them. Right, okay. So along comes this, and he was a charlatan, Elijah Muhammad, and tries to give them a pseudo-scientific a version of Islam, and people believed it because they were looking for something to get positive self-esteem. This is the important thing. People wanted this positive self-esteem. They wanted a psychic conversion. Now, my second degree was in social psychology. My PhD was in social psychology, and I looked at how Pakistanis felt in Scotland about their identity. And one of the things which psychologists say, right, okay, is that if you want to get on in life, if you want to accomplish things, the first thing you have to do is have a positive self-esteem. A positive self-esteem. You've got to say, you've got to look in the mirror and say, I'm worthy of this, right? But think about what black people seen in America in the 1960s. Now, I teach popular culture. What they seen is if they looked at film in America, was it they seen people going, yes sir, no sir, three bags, no sir. That's what they seen. What they seen was a slave mentality. That is what they seen. So you could understand why black people were having a low self-esteem, a low self-worth. And what Cornel West is an American academic, basically says, you know, that what Malcolm X tried to do was he tried to show black people that if you have enough love, if you love yourself enough, you can have what's called a psychic conversion in yourself. You can show appreciation to yourself. Okay, and this leads on to greater things. So don't see yourself through white lenses. See yourself through your own history, your own culture. Now, think about that. Okay, now, these days, right now, 2012, right, one of the main things I teach about is Islamophobia in the media. Okay, so I'm saying to all of you people here who are Muslims, okay, sisters, you're oppressed. Look at your oppressed wearing your headscarves. That's what it says in the media. Okay, that's what it says all the time in the media, that you people, that you sisters are oppressed. Okay, brothers, the chances are, if you pray, okay, if you go to the mosque, you're a terrorist. Yeah, so that's what it says. What I do in my first year lecture is there's a concept called semiology. It's the science of language. And I say, okay, I have 100, 150 students, right? predominantly white non-Muslims, and I say, if I say the word Muslim, what do you think of? And they all say, and I say, look, you won't offend me. I know I'm only 5'5", okay, but you won't offend. What do you think of? And they go, terrorist, bad person, suicide bomber, etc., etc. Okay, that's what comes in their head. So, but you people know that through Islam, okay, you know through knowledge of your own reading that you shouldn't look at yourself through the white lens of the media. Does that make sense to everyone? You know that what you call, that what you believe in is something different, okay? And that's, and Malcolm X was trying to say to people, don't look at what the media shows you. Don't look at that. You know, find knowledge for yourself, basically. And it was this kind of looking for knowledge. That's what Vandy Burr basically says. It's this which energised and educated black Americans to the idea of what's called political pluralism. Right, and what Vandy Burr is basically saying, blacks turned around and said, I'm not just going to look at what you call the civil rights movement in isolation, I'm going to look at what's happening in Africa, okay, and relate that to what's happening to African Americans in the USA. I'm going to relate what's happening to the Palestinians. In 1971, a man called Huey Newton, has anyone heard of him? Huey Newton, member of the Black Panther Party, one of the founders of the Black Panther Party, he wrote an article, right, and the article was why black people should support the Palestinian struggle. You know, that's what he was talking about, why people in Oakland, California should support Palestinians. This is the idea of political pluralism. Where did Huey Newton get his ideas from? He got them from the Brother Minister. He got them from Malcolm X. The Black Panthers used to call themselves the sons and daughters of Malcolm X. Okay? Malcolm's everywhere, you know, these days. He's in culture. Think of one of the most iconic photographs and how it was taken by hip-hop culture, etc. At the moment, I've just finished an article on Malcolm X, Islam, and hip-hop. And if you look, and I was talking about a group called Outlandish. Has anyone heard of a group called Outlandish? They're from Denmark. Okay, two of the members are Muslims, and I actually talk about a song called Aisha. Okay, and I relate that to Islam and the origins of hip hop, and then I relate all that to everything. Anything I write, by the way, gets related to Malcolm X or Muhammad Ali. Like, my students just basically know that if they give me a Muhammad Ali video or something like that, they'll get a first class degree. Right. So, I mean, that's what I was trying to do. Now, but what is this idea of political blackness then? This idea of what was called political pluralism. If you think of this idea of political blackness, right, okay. Another article that I finished off writing is an article called My Jihad. Right, okay, and I had to write this thing about 10 years after 9/11. Okay, now, if any of you came up to me in 2000, 2001, and said, Amir, are you a Muslim? I'd say, no. No, I'm not a Muslim. I'd say, I am a Marxist. And I think religion is the opium of the masses. It's what Marx believes in. It deludes us. Okay, it keeps us fixed in here. Okay, it distracts us from real things. My mum, she, and all my family are all religious. I was not religious. They would frown at me. They'd go, oh, you know, Amir, what's he done? What have we done? Oh my, you know. And I used to. So this is. Then boom, 9/11 happens. Okay, everywhere I hear, Muslims are this, Muslims are that. Are you one of them, Amir? You know, and I'm thinking, whoa. So that's when I started in the last 10 years looking towards Islam for answers, looking towards the hadiths of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Okay, that's when I started looking towards it, right? Then, and that's what I called my jihad, my struggle. Okay, now if you think of the idea of, but if you ask me in 19, sorry, if you ask me in 2000, Amir, how would you describe yourself? I'd say I am black. That's what I would say, I am black. Because in Scotland growing up, I was called a black so-and-so. Too many times to remember, too many times, honestly. I mean, in Scotland, I mean this is the stupidity of racism. I mean, I'm sure all of you have been called these names, okay, but I was called, growing up in Glasgow, an Ethiopian, right? A Somalian, obviously the P word, a Bangladeshi, sorry, a dirty Bangladeshi, right? Okay, a Kaffir, okay, obviously the N word, both N words, Negro and the more offensive one, right? And obviously the good old favourite, you're black. Okay, you know, luckily no one ever called me a Rangers fan, because I support Celtic, then I got really angry. Right, okay, so I used to think of myself as black, okay, because I'd say, look what's happening to the American Indians, it's happening to them because they're not white. Look what's happening to black people in Africa, it's happening to them because they're not white. Look what's happening to Chinese people, it's because they're not white. The sweatshops in Vietnam are happening because these people are not white. The sweatshops in Malaysia, the child prostitution in Thailand, it's all happening. And I'd say it's all the fault of globalisation and white people. Rich white people, okay? The elite, right? And this is the idea of what's called political blackness, okay? Black then becomes what's called a political colour, okay? It's not a skin colour, okay? It becomes a political colour. Okay, and it was a concept very popular in the 70s and 80s. Okay, however, if you think of the idea of the Ummah then, it's very similar to the idea of political blackness. Right, okay, because what the Ummah does, right, sorry, I was going to play this clip for you, it probably wouldn't have time because it's quite long. Okay, what the Ummah does, as you know, it basically says you're a Muslim first and foremost, and everything else is subservient to that. Okay, it's what academics would call an imagined community. And I don't know if anyone's doing social sciences or anything like that, but like there was a book written in 1983 by a person called Benedict Anderson called "Imagined Communities." It was about national identity. It was basically something which was imagined. And it could be argued that what's happening with the Ummah is an imagined community. So everyone here, now, and the way that this works, right, is, I think, is to do with the idea of self-esteem. So participants may be drawing strength from an Islamic identity which can provide solidarity with other Muslims as well as an avenue of escape from constantly identified in negative terms. Okay. So think about it. If I turn round, right, to you people, okay, and I say, you're nothing but a black so-and-so, a terrorist, okay, or a Paki so-and-so in Britain. Now, if, especially if I use the word Paki, sorry for offending anyone, okay? Now, that means by using that term, I'm turning around and saying, you belong to a small minority in Britain, okay, which is relatively powerless. Okay, but if that person turns around and says, I'm not a Paki, I'm a Muslim, then, whoa, it's not 1 million people in Britain, it's 1 billion people across the globe. Does that make sense? So it then becomes, you think about that as an avenue, as a way of getting self-esteem, okay? And that's, I think, is very similar to the concept of political blackness. In the 1960s, in the 50s, you had a conference called the Bandung Conference, B-E-N-D-U-N-G, right? And I still look back on it and I think, oh man, I wish something happened from that. And that's when all the colonised countries got together and said, we're no longer colonised, we're going to move forward together. Right, unfortunately, it never happened because of a variety of different reasons. And I think that what happens now is that young Muslims, okay, in Western countries, regardless, they might regard themselves as a minority, okay, if they think of themselves as Muslims globally, they regard themselves as something powerful. That's why, you know what I mean, Muslims tend to, and studies have reflected this, is that young British Muslims tend to have a more political outlook and a more international outlook, etc. And I mean, I talk to my students about that, you know, in terms of research. If I say to you people Al Jazeera, I'm sure most people here have heard of it, right? Trust me, I teach 300 media students, right, who are predominantly white. I say Al Jazeera to them and they go, Al who? Is he the new signing for Chelsea? You know, and it's sad, it happens time and time again. So this is the idea of the Ummah. And this relates to the idea of, obviously, of understanding Islam, right? Now, when I give my lecture on Malcolm X to my students, right, and I sort of play it up a wee bit, right, and I turn around, right, and I say, because, I say, in the autobiography of Malcolm X, right, it actually says, and I always say, because, now, please bear with me, and for the white people here, I don't mean any offence, don't beat me up. I'm playing football tomorrow with all white people, okay? White people, I don't mind you. You're not bad. Small doses. Okay? Sorry, I've only been cheeky there, honestly. Most of my friends are white. Right, okay? But, sorry, what was I doing? Apart from insulting white people. In my lecture, what I do, right, is I talk about Malcolm X, right, and I say, if you look at Malcolm X's speeches when he was in the Nation of Islam, he'd always go, blonde-haired, blue-eyed devil, no good in you, no... Sorry, I looked at you there, mate, now. I do apologise, right, okay? I don't mean anything by it, right, okay? Are you English?
Yeah.
Yeah, well I hate you more because of that, probably, right? Being Scottish, right, okay. Right, so I would say any Malcolm X speech would be blonde-haired, blue-eyed devils, no good in them, no justice in them, they're going to be destroyed. These blonde-haired, blue-eyed devils caused the ozone layer. These blonde-haired, blue-eyed devils caused famine in Africa. These blonde-haired, blue-eyed devils caused starvation in India. And I say to my students, that meant something to me. I thought, this is great. Somebody speaking. And then I go, but then, I'm reading Malcolm X's autobiography, I'm going, this is brilliant, this is great. It's you know, it gives me a sense of purpose. But then, I go, then Malcolm X goes to Mecca. And he comes out with the letter of the letter from Mecca, which I'm, you know, I've please work.
At Jeddah in Saudi Arabia, on the way to Mecca, I remember the ancient words of Allah. Proclaim the pilgrimage among men. They will come on foot and upon lean camel. Will come from every deep ravine. From Mecca, the holy city of Islam, I wrote to friends in America. Never have I witnessed such sincere hospitality and true brotherhood as is practiced here in this ancient holy land, the home of Abraham, Muhammad, and all the other prophets of the Holy Scriptures. You may be shocked at these words coming from me, but what I have seen has forced me to rearrange much of my thought patterns previously held, to toss aside some of my previous conclusions. For during the past 11 days, I have eaten from the same plate, drunk from the same glass, slept on the same rug, and prayed to the same God with fellow Muslims whose eyes were the bluest of blue, whose hair was the blondest of blonde, and whose skin was the whitest of white. We are truly the same because their belief in one God has removed the white from their minds, the white from their behavior, and the white from their attitudes. Wearing the Iran garb of a pilgrim, I made the seven circuits around the Kaaba. I drank from the sacred well of Zemzem. I ran between the hills of Safa and Marwa. I stood on Mount Ararat and with my brothers proclaimed, I come, O Lord, I come. God is great. Lead us, O Lord, in peace. And for the first time in my 39 years on this earth, I stood before the Creator of all, and felt like a complete human being. Sincerely, El Hajj Malik El Shabab.
So when you think of that quote, right, because I turned around and I said, now, I read that in the other thing from Malcolm X, and I went, oh my God, Malcolm X likes white people, threw it on the ground. And then I went, but wait a minute, now think what Brother Malcolm was saying here. People are not racist because of their skin colour. There's only, I think it's four genes which determine skin tone in a human body. And, you know, and to think about that way is just idiotic. Right, okay. Believe it or not, there's black racists, there's Arab racists, there's white racists, right, okay. And you look what it says in the Holy Quran as well, right, okay. I look at my own family now, right. I was born in Pakistan, in Karachi. My dad was born in Agra, in India, okay. He died in Glasgow, and there's not a day that goes by that I miss him. I miss him so much. And in my family now, okay. I've got five brothers and four sisters. We have Algerians, Afghans, white Scottish people, white Irish people in that family tree now, right? All Muslims, okay, in that family tree now. You know, and that's what I think of when I think of the letter from Mecca. Okay, and I think of the quote from the Holy Quran there. You know, now, but then if you think of how is Islam? I mean, look at the two quotes that I've given you on Islam so far, right? You probably know better than I do. Why do people hate it? Why? Why are people scared of it? Okay, this is to do with the media, right? So American society and Western society is accustomed to thinking of British culture as Christian or American culture as Christian, etc. Right, and that's not the case. And one of my previous articles, I've said that Islam and Muslims is always seen as something alien, something un-American. And the best example of that is when Barack Obama was fighting for an election. People were actually worried: is he a Muslim? Is he a Muslim? As if That's what was going to lose him votes. That was the important thing. Is he a Muslim? You know what I mean? And when Barack Obama said stuff like, you know, when he heard the call for prayer, he thought it was a beautiful thing. You know, and people were like, oh, he shouldn't be saying that. And there's even, believe it or not, photographs of Barack Obama taken with sisters in hijabs, and they were photoshopped out, etc. Because people were worried that this would lose votes. Okay. That Islam was seen as something regressive. But then, if you think of Brother Malcolm, then right. Now he is my. I mean, honestly, I mean, I've got. I think you should. I mean, if it wasn't because of Malcolm X, I would not become. I would not become a university lecturer. I know I wouldn't, because Malcolm X has spurred me on to get more and more knowledge. And with the help of my mum and dad, I've managed to sort of become a sort of lecturer and do what I love doing. And but think about how Malcolm X is represented. I've had white people, okay, come up to me and say, Malcolm killed white people. What? And they actually believe it. Malcolm killed white people. I'm like, where? When? How? Tell me about it. And they believe it. They actually believe it because of what Malcolm X believed in and what he stood for. And this is from Alex Haley, this is from the autobiography. When I am dead, he will make use of me, as he has made use of me alive, a convenience symbol of hatred. And that will help him to escape facing the truth that all I've done is hold a mirror to reflect and show the history of unspeakable crimes that his race has committed. You know, so even... Brother Malcolm is saying that's what's going to happen. That quote continues and it says, you know, that if all I've tried to do is expose some truth on this malignant cancer called racism in America, and he goes, if I have achieved that, all praise is due to Allah, only the mistakes have been mine. And that's how he finishes his autobiography. You know what I mean? I've said this time and time again, if you don't believe me, get the Malcolm X book and read it, you know what I mean? And if I'm wrong, I'll give you some money. Okay, right, that's what he actually says, right? But look at how he's treated, right? And then, I mean, any kind of academic study on Islam shows that Muslims are always treated as the opposite of the West, the opposite of progression, that they're some way regressive. And then there's a focus on these extremists and fundamentalists, right? So if you think about, now look at the Malcolm X quote with skillful manipulation of the press, they're able to make the criminal look like the victim, and the victim look like the criminal. That's what it should say. So it hasn't come up. Now think of these events which have happened. I've chosen to look at them because I think they're really useful. The top one was the ban minarets in Switzerland. In March of last year, I gave a paper on Islamophobia to the Human Rights Council at the United Nations in Geneva. Right, and I seen these posters myself. I couldn't believe it. I think there's only 4 minarets in all of Switzerland, and that was deemed too many. Right, this gentleman here wanted to burn a Quran a day, and notice what I said, that representations of Islam are always the opposite of Christianity. Well, what? Now, he was a so-called Christian minister. Why would he want to burn the Quran? The second most quoted prophet in the Holy Quran is Isa. You know, Hazrat Isa, we all know that. You know, Jesus Christ. So he wants to burn the words of Jesus Christ. You know, not very Christian-like, is it? Right, and then, I like this one. Muslim plot to kill the Pope. Right, this is the front page of the Daily Express. Apparently some cleaners were going to kill the Pope. Turned out it was a total lie. They just made it up. They actually arrested, they brought in the cleaners, questioned them, etc. And then they kind of went, they were just cleaning the street, because they're cleaners. Right, but of course the Express never followed up in that story. You know, now, that's because the idea of Islam is always seen as something violent. So if you think of the concept of jihad, okay, now, if I say jihad to most people, they think violence or suicide bombing or etc. We all know that's not the case. We all know, you know, a jihad is all about debate, reasoning. It's your inner struggle. That's what it's about. You know, and look what it says in the Holy Quran. If you kill one person, you've killed them all. Okay, but these concepts are very rarely represented in the sort of media for a variety of different reasons. Right, I think that if you examine Brother Malcolm's life, that there's another good way of thinking about it. Yes, Malcolm's life was a jihad, it was a struggle. He was trying to get his voice across, but also he always wanted to, you know, if he had new knowledge, he's willing to change. He's willing to move forward. Now, think about that. How many politicians nowadays go, oh, I believe Iraq has weapons of mass destruction. I believe that working class people from Britain should go there and kill Iraqis. Okay. This is what I strongly believe in. And this is what Tony Blair said, and George Bush said that, because God has told me. If you read your speech, Tony Blair actually said that God told him to attack Iraq. And George Bush said it as well. Okay. But no one calls him fundamentalists or extremists, right? Okay. And then look at Tony Blair's autobiography. Does he apologise for what's happened? No. And Malcolm X always said that, you know, if he was wrong, he would apologise. And he did. He apologised about this, his idea of racial ideology, his idea of the Nation of Islam, and a variety of other things he apologised for. He's relevant today. For Barack Obama, talking about, in Barack Obama's autobiography, that what Malcolm said was that, you know, that discipline and a commitment, you're able to change something. It's idea of self-creation, self-esteem, self-worth. It's a psychic conversion again, you know. And you've noticed, hopefully you'll notice the idea of always changing there from those quotes today. Now, people have always talked, when they talk about Brother Malcolm, they always focus on his rage and his anger. Right, okay, and I'm guilty of that, right, okay, because that's how I met Malcolm X, right. But, you know, the greatest moment of my academic career, right, was when I met Malcolm X's bodyguard in 2005 in America at a conference in Malcolm X where I was giving a paper. And Malcolm X's bodyguard came up to me, and he was about 6'6", long, long black dreadlocks, and boy, I was like, okay, and he came up to me and went, oh, I liked your speech, and then he had to bow down, because I'm only 5'5", and he's 6'6", right, and he said, you know, Malcolm, he had a sense of humour, right, and I went, oh, okay, no problem, I'm not going to mess with you, you're 6'6", right, and that's what he said to me, and think about it, right, why do we not think about Malcolm and the idea of social justice, you know, it is. If you think of the first converts to Islam, they were women and slaves. The converts, it could be argued, and I've argued this before, and I'm going to argue it again at a conference about Marxism in our place, that it could be argued the cornerstones of the welfare state are in Islam, the idea of zakat and charity, etc. Right, okay. And surely this is nothing bad. I mean, is this militant? This was an article myself, one of my PhD students wrote about radical Muslims. Because in my opinion, there's a difference between a radical Muslim and a militant Muslim. But even the word radical, I mean, what is radical about saying everyone should have a nice house and 3 meals a day and a chance of a good education and good health? Is that radical? I think that's human. That's what I think. Right, okay. And Malcolm X, great quote. You know, one night I lay awake amid sleeping brothers and I learned that pilgrims from every land, every colour and class and rank, all snored in the same language. I think that is beautiful. I want to play one more clip, right? It's 5 minutes long, right? Please indulge me, okay, because it's a really nice clip, but the bit at the start is I'd like you to focus on, and the bit at the very, very end. And the stuff in the middle is just beautiful. It's not me. Please work.
Do you consider yourself militant? I can feel my breath now.
Like the river I've been around. Starting to change their mode of thinking, in that they were now starting to recognise the international solidarity, starting to work with the trade unions, starting to recognise that the working class whites were suffering similarly, and most importantly, starting to oppose the war in Vietnam.
But would you want me to take a couple of questions? Do you want me to answer that, or do you want to take a couple of questions? It's up to you people. I totally agree with you. I agree with you 100%. Okay, people talk about there's a book called Martin and Malcom, okay, by a person called James Cohen, C-O-N-E, right? And the popular perception is that Martin Luther King was the opposite of Malcolm X. That's just rubbish, absolute rubbish. If you look at Dr. King's speeches, especially from 1965 onwards. Malcolm was actually saying them 3 years before. Right, okay, because that quote that I put up at the very, very start, okay, at the very, very start, this idea of the internationalist outlook, right, when soon as Dr. King started saying, I don't want to just talk about, you know, being able to wash my hands in the same sink as a white person. I want to know why black people are going to Vietnam to fight and white working class people are going to Vietnam to fight. Then he becomes dangerous. He becomes totally dangerous. And what he was saying is virtually similar to what Malcolm X was saying. Now that clip, the very, very end, was when Malcolm X spoke at the Oxford Union, I think it was. I think it was 1965, right? It was just weeks before he died. We can only use hindsight and postulate and guess. I would have been amazed if between 1965 and 1968, if Martin Luther King and Malcolm X never got together and said, look, what can we do together? In 1963, Malcolm X called the march in Washington a bit of a farce. which I kind of agreed with as well, slightly. But 19s, I totally agree with you. I think if you read the sort of James Cone book, C-O-N-E, I think it is, he actually talks, he basically says, look, these people were talking about not racial ideology, but class ideology or capitalist ideology.
Any other questions?
So I was just going to come back on. Yeah. Isn't there then a contradiction in us saying that Ummah becomes important? Because the Ummah essentially isn't about international solidarity. It is, but only amongst a certain group. And that there's an inherent contradiction for me in that the Muslims have a ruling class, just mm-hmm. like everybody else.
Yeah.
Okay. And as a Marxist, or a Marxist might argue, that by identifying ourselves just in this term, Ummah, it might be slightly detrimental to the overall
cause of
human liberation, as we're seeing in Egypt, as we're seeing in
Egypt. I kind of agree with you, right, okay. I think from a personal perspective, I think the idea of the Ummah is very, very important for a psychological perspective, right, to feel less powerless, if that makes sense, right, okay. But it's what's called an imaginary community. It's never existed. If people believe in it, that's fine. But if they believe in it and what you do something positive with it, that's good. But it has never existed in the Islamic world. It's never ever existed. All you've got to do is look upon. If you want to look at the, Fred Halliday's got a book called. He's a sociologist called. Islam and the Myth of Confrontation. The number one victims of Islamic terrorism are not Christians, they're other Muslims. Simple as that. The number one victims, okay, are other Muslims, right? And I can remember getting into a massive debate where I was told I was a bad Muslim and etc. by a person because I was saying, well, look, you know, when Muslims are killing Muslims, it's just, you know, who benefits? You know, who benefits? And even if you want to go back to the kind of racial thinking, Malcolm X said that, you know, when black people are attacking black people, it's just wrong, you know. And I do agree with you. And I do think that as a concept, it can give you self-esteem and power, a psychological, but I think it's very difficult to move forward with that, you know, because, a very good example is what happened in Iraq. Now, I don't know if you know what happened in Iraq, right, okay, but when the occupation started, and it wasn't occupation, it wasn't anything else, right, okay, which obviously Sunnis and Shiis, there was fights between Sunni Muslims and Shiite Muslims, correct? Everyone knows that, right, okay. Then what happened, right, was that Al-Qaeda in Iraq was formed, okay, which was a Sunni Muslim group based off non-Iraqi Arabs, okay, and then they started attacking Iraqi Sunni Muslims as well, okay? And eventually what had to happen was Iraqi Sunni Muslims had to get together with some Shia Muslims to stop this Al-Qaeda-based group, okay, to what you call do the attacks. However, this I know I'm giving you a headache now, okay, but this group called Al-Qaeda in Iraq actually had fallen out with so-called Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan as well, and it just gets complicated. It's a very complicated thing. Sister,
I don't agree with you that the Ummah is only a concept that's useful at an individual level. I think if you look at Islamic teachings, the Ummah is there in terms of promoting international solidarity between Muslims. And a Muslim, you know, you can define a Muslim in different ways. You can define a Muslim by affiliation and a Muslim by practice. Somebody who is born into a Muslim family, doesn't practice Islam, doesn't feel this sense of affinity with other people in other parts of this world. So, you know, the teaching about Ummah is that if a Muslim feels a pain in any part of their body, then that's used to describe the Ummah. So me here in England can feel pain for other people in Palestine because they are part of the Ummah as well. So it's not just a case of any person, it's about believers and about buying into that concept of international solidarity. Yeah. So I don't agree with you that this is just an individual concept.
Well, no, if you, what I'd said was if you use it for progressive purposes, because I think the idea, because you could use the idea of international outlook for regressive. And if you let me explain that, white people or black people could turn around, right, and say, all black people should get together, okay, and internationally as black people, and oppress in every other group, if that makes sense. Okay, I personally love the concept of the Ummah because it's an international concept, but when I went to Thailand last year, okay, I felt pain at watching poor Buddhists in the street begging for money, okay, and the fact that they were not Muslim didn't really bother me, okay. My wife and me sponsored a couple of children from Vietnam. I've never ever asked what faith that they are. It doesn't bother me. To me, they're part of, if you want to call it the Ummah, that's fine. I would call it the international world or a human being. Okay.
Being part of the Ummah doesn't mean you're excluded from being part of humanity, yeah, but, as well.
But what I'm saying, sister, is, you know, I mean, that's your perspective, and it's a perspective which I agree with if you're using it for progressive. But other people are not going to use it for progressive.
Well, it carries certain criteria with it. You know, you can't say I'm part of an Ummah when you're not actually following Islamic principles. Mm-hmm. You know, if you look at
the sort of recent the recent declaration by Al Zakawari, where he's now called for Muslims from everywhere to go to Syria and fight the Assad regime. Okay. Now, he's invoking the idea of the Ummah there. He's asking Muslims from everywhere who feel anger about Assad to go there and fight. I think he's doing it for regressive reasons, not progressive reasons.
The same thing's happened with the concept of democracy. People are going to go and fight for the democracy of others when we know they're abusing that whole concept.
Barack Obama, good example. Tony Blair, David Cameron, good example. Yeah, I agree with you. But it's upon your intent in it. I mean, like, there's a guy called Edward Saeed, I don't know if you've heard of him, a Palestinian writer who's actually a Christian, and he talks about the idea of what the challenge was, he said, was mutual people with differences living together. And that was the challenge, you know, and... some people are going to say that will never happen. Some people are going to say it could happen. I do agree with you. You know what I mean? I think the Ummah can be used for progressive. Okay, but
it's meant to be.
Yeah, but as the brother said before, right? Yeah, but as the brother said there before, it can be used by the elites for regressive as well. Yeah. Well, yeah, but.
Okay.
Well, I mean, I'm not an expert on Islamic theology. I'm sorry. I've got three or four people who will now want to beat me up or something like that. I think I've offended everyone.
I think Osman's had his hand up. Shall we take a few? And then
yeah, that's fine. Yeah, no hassle.
Do you want a pen here?
Yeah.
That's not a writing.
Sorry.
So if we take Osman's question first.
I think it's important to look at the Ummah. There's a bit of confusion in what you're saying, as in you can't deny the existence of the Ummah just because it's not existent on a political basis, because the Ummah is an ideology, a belief system. So if any person holds that belief system, they become part of the Ummah. It's not necessarily defined as, in terms of the Ummah, there can be a different set of laws within the Sharia, there can be adherence to laws of each country. So if, for example, we're living here, we have to adhere to the laws of this country. Somebody else living somewhere else has to do the same, yet we're still part of the same Ummah, but we're following different laws. So on a purely ideological basis, you have to say that the Ummah, you can't say the Ummah doesn't exist. That brotherhood is there. And the reasoning for that brotherhood wouldn't be to say that being part of this Ummah gives me a greater power. the fact that you believe in God is what gives you that power to stand up for yourself, not the fact that you're part of a bigger group or a smaller group. Because within the same ummah is the belief that we're all part of a brotherhood in humanity as well. That's part of the foundation of saying that you're from this ummah.
Okay.
Mustafa? In one of your papers on Malcolm X, you say that if Malcolm X was alive today, he'd probably be in Guantanamo Bay.
You've read that paper?
You also said it. You said that maybe perhaps today in these prisons, Guantanamo Bay, and in the UK, place like Belmarsh, there's a Malcolm X who at some point will come out. Could you develop that a little bit for us?
I'll do my best, okay? There's two or three people there, or five people there.
Yeah, next to you, please.
I was really glad that the conversation went down this way, because I was sort of nervous about asking a question. In that I'm not a religious person, but I think I'm open to, or I'm on a journey trying to find where I feel a faith as such. And I have felt recently, an intense love for everybody and towards myself, or appreciation of how special I am as an individual and how special everybody else is as an individual, which feels very much like being talked to or touched by faith, as people describe it. But then I'm cautious about religion because of the trouble it caused, like the killing and the within people and their own people and within all faiths. And the discussion now at the end has sort of gone down that route, and just like discuss that. You said before that you would not have said you were a religious person 10 years ago. Obviously, your position on that has changed. Why?
Slightly, yeah, okay.
I was wondering whether you think my gut instinct that maybe religion causes more problems, that you can feel and you can learn and go on these journeys without needing to categorise yourself as a group and then cause dislike or not knowing that the people, what's your. I don't know what your sentence is on.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Just going off what the system really put on my said before as well. One thing that I didn't really pick up from what you said, if you could explain it, was your definition of ummah. From what I've always applied, is the definition being as what the Prophet described as being the ummah. And that differs completely different to what. If you look at the modern Muslim community, you look at places like Syria and Egypt and so on, I wouldn't exactly call that an ummah with the ruling class, I'd just call that a tyrannical rule. That's completely different to what the concept of an ummah is. Mm-hmm. To describe the ummah as what it is today would be a massive misconception. And in terms of the wider international community, I think the teachings of the Prophet are lost in there as well. The teachings of the Prophet are lost in there as well, in the sense that essentially within a Muslim's nature and within the Ummah is to be ethically aware of others' needs as well. And within the message of the Prophet, one of the key messages was even if non-Muslims come out with a treaty, a UN resolution, whatever you want to call it, which promotes ethics, it should be accepted. And I think that's a key part of ummah. It should be accepted. So
yeah.
An ethical sort of treaty. It should be accepted. I think that's a key part of an Islamic ummah and not a modern ummah, as in terms of what can be.
Can I just add to that? For example, in the constitution of Medina, even the ummah was considered the Jews that lived there as well.
Yeah.
They were part of that brotherhood. So it's the same concept.
It seemed the idea of the Pakistani flag, the sort of white part of the Pakistani flag is meant to symbolise all minorities as well. I think it's a couple of people. I'll do my best to answer them all.
I think if Malcolm X was alive today, he'd advocate more 9/11 than 7/7. Because even though he transformed at the end of his life.
Sorry, could you say that again?
if Malcolm X was still alive today, do you think he'd want more 7-7s and 9-11s? Because even though he transformed at the end of his life, it just seemed he moved away from Elijah Muhammad's teachings, and it was more about understanding that white people could be Muslims and brown people could be Muslims and all the rest of it. But
okay,
would
okay.
he target non-Muslims now and think that
okay.
Muslims as a whole should do that?
You're making me work, aren't you? Jeez, man. I'm not getting paid for this, by the way.
Yeah, it's probably all right.
Yeah, I just want to say that this Malcolm X is a great man. He said that he did a lot of good things for humanity in general. But you don't think we should always go back to the person, really, and the prophet, let's say, Muhammad, who he is, and he was still the best example to follow as a human being.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, on the left.
Just wanted to mention the Tony Blair being unapologetic about the whole war, Iraq war. I just wanted to ask, I think most of the law activists have, most activists have said that we know that the war was done by the UN treaty. I was just wondering, what from your experiences, what is being done in order to bring down Bush and Tony Blair under the ICC, anything like that?
Okay. Does anyone want to raise their hands and...
Any sisters, have you been quiet for once?
Okay, right. Thanks very much. I'm starving. Right, I'll try to go, I'll do my best. Okay, now remember, I am not an Islamic theologian, right, okay? I don't claim to be an expert, even on my chosen field, right, okay, of, if you want to call it cultural studies or race or racism, because I think that if you do that, you're holding yourself hostage to fortune, saying that you know it all, be it all, because knowledge is always, there's always new things happening, etc. Right, okay. But I'll do my best, and I'm glad it sparked off some kind of debate, because that's the whole idea of it. I mean, it's the spark off debate, you know, whether you agree with, and you have to realise that some of the quotes, etc. that I've put up, I've only paraphrased people, if that makes sense. If you actually read, and maybe the questions which you're asking might be in the books of these people, if that makes sense. Does that make sense to everyone? Okay, I mean, because like, I keep on saying, like last Monday, I do a lecture on the concept of ideology in Marxism, and I say to my students, I've got 45 minutes to explain Marxism to you. You know, Marx wrote 12 volumes of Das Kapital alone. Okay, so you have to read the actual stuff, basically. So I'll do my best, right? I'll go with the easy one first, right, if there was one, right, okay. But the brother at the end talked about Tony Blair and the ideas of the laws. Well, I mean, as far as I'm aware, okay, nothing has been done to what you call, nothing has been done officially to try these people for so-called war crimes, etc. There could be, okay, there is a journalist called John Pilger, I hope people have heard about, right, and he suggests that there's plenty of evidence, if there's a will there, to try these people for war crimes, okay, not just George, not just Tony Blair, but George Bush, and a variety of people in the US and the UK cabinets for lying, basically, and for committing war crimes, okay, now, but there needs to be a political will there, okay, and I don't think that there is a political will there. But, may I add, right, okay, that there is a, I think it's New Hampshire, now, I might be wrong, in America, and the governor there has actually, when George Bush was in power, he actually put in a law which said that if George Bush ever enters that state, he'd be arrested, okay, and George Bush never ever entered that state, because he could be arrested, right, okay, so... But in terms of like, has anything happened? I mean, I'm not I'm not actually aware of it, right, okay? I'm not, I mean, I do know, if you haven't seen a documentary called The War You Don't See by John Pilger, I don't know if any of you heard of that documentary? The War You Don't See, I recommend watching it. It basically starts off with Iraqis being shot dead by American soldiers on a helicopter pilot ship, right? And basically, it turns out that the people that they shot dead were school children, a camera person, another journalist, etc. And nothing's been done about that, right? So I don't think there's a political will there, unfortunately, right? Okay. In relation to your question, you know, I mean, this talks about Malcolm X, right, okay? Now, as I explained right at the start, right, okay, or tried to explain, if you asked me 10 years ago, 15, 20 years ago, am I religious, I'd say no. I would honestly say no. You know what I mean? When I went to learn about the Quran when I was like 10, 11, 12 years old, I can tell you right now that more often than not, I'd say, Mum, I'm going to the school, okay? And then me and my friends would go and play football instead. Then we'd come back and go, yeah, it was really hard today. You know, and that's what we would do. I was not like, you know, okay. My kind of way was fighting racism, okay? Now, that's just my own personal way, and that's where Brother Malcolm inspired me. However, Brother Malcolm turns around and does say in his biography, only the mistakes have been his. If he's exposed any truth, all praise is due to Allah. You know, he actually says it. So you are basically right, you know. And I think, you know, and if you look at Malcolm X's life, okay, even though he was getting followed by the FBI and CIA, etc., right, all of them said he was, as a moral character, he was flawless, absolutely flawless. Okay, and I don't think anyone, can doubt that, basically, in my opinion. I mean, you are basically right, but even the actual brother says that as well, okay? But this is why I'm doing the talk, if that makes sense, okay? Okay. The one about 9/11 and 7/7, right, I think that's a really interesting question, right, okay? Because in Manning Marable's new book called Malcolm X, A Life of Reinvention, Manning Marable, and I agree with him, says that Malcolm X would disagree with Al-Qaeda. The reason that you disagree with Al-Qaeda is because when 9/11 happened, you know, Muslims died as well, okay? And people forget that. And in 7/7, right, he disagreed with Al-Qaeda's so-called inter-ethnic violence, okay? You know, like and how they attack Shia Muslims, Sunni Muslims who don't agree with them, etc., you know, and that, so I would think that Brother Malcolm, you know what I mean, would not advocate 9/11s and 7/7s, if that makes sense. I don't think he'd advocate that, okay, because that means the indiscriminate killing of people, okay. I do think that he'd advocate something which is slightly even more, it's another form of struggle, which is saying we have to change our ideological way that we actually think about the actual world, okay? So if you think about the idea of terrorism, okay, too often the word terrorism is associated with bombings, 9/11, 7/7, etc., right, okay? But if you want to look at real terrorism, think about the idea of how the globalised world denied food to certain parts of the world depending upon how they behave. Does that make sense to you? What terrorism is basically meant to be, right, is it's the threat of force to produce a political end for a benefactor. Does that make sense to you? So what I might do is I might turn around and say, all of you people have to, what you call, behave this way. If you don't, I'm going to shoot you all. So it's you know, I don't have to do it, I can just threaten you. That's the idea of terrorism, okay? But certain countries use that, not with bombing and stuff like that, but like they apply sanctions, okay?
At the Oxford Union speech, he still sticks to his line by any means necessary.
If you think of fighting racism, I think fighting racism 9/10 is ideological, 1/10 is physical. You know what I mean? So being militant doesn't have to mean, you know, like throwing petrol bombs or attacking somebody. It could be mean saying, right, okay, I'm going to organise. Okay, I'm going to let people if you look at what the Nation of Islam did, they organised black communities. If you go back 50 years before the Nation of Islam in America, there was a movement called the Marcus Garvey movement, and they organised black people in America to say, look, if we have purchasing power, we have power. If that makes sense, okay, you know. And I often think that if you wanted to solve the Palestinian question, you know what I mean? Why couldn't the Arab world, the so-called Muslim world, get together and use their economic power to sort that out? It doesn't have to be political, violent power, if that makes sense. Mary Marable says that Malcolm X would have disagreed with Al-Qaeda. I think that would be the case as well, because it means minorities killing minorities, for want of a better description. The idea of the Ummah, right, which a couple of you have asked me for, have talked about, right? Okay. Now, again, I mean, I am not a religious theologian, but like that comes from the work from a woman called Jessica Jacobson, right? Okay, and she does say that what you call that it's an attractive way for people who feel powerless to think about, you know. Okay, now I think, going back to what the very first question, what the brother said at the back there, right, okay, about the idea of the Ummah and what the sister said who's now left, right, okay, you know, it depends on how you think about that. You know, if you think about the idea of national identity, right, okay, let's forget the idea of the Ummah, just think about national identity. You could think about national identity either in what's called an exclusive way or an inclusive way. So I can turn around, right, and say anyone who's got a British passport is British. Does that make sense? However, the British National Party will come out and say you have to be white to be British. Okay, now, they're both still thinking about this idea of national identity, of collective belonging, but they're approaching it in different ways. You know what I mean? Going back to the very first question, right, me personally, I think I've got more in common, and it kind of touches upon what you're saying as well, sir. Right, okay. I think that I've got more in common with a white working class guy in Glasgow, right, okay, who's trying to get a job, okay, who's living in a housing scheme, than I have with the Muslim elite in Saudi Arabia, just because they're Muslims. You know, I mean, they might have gone, oh, we're Muslims, you're a Muslim, we should be together. I'm not, you know.
The point isn't that you have something more in common, the point is that you have the same ideology.
Yeah, but not
in terms of your lifestyle or your laws, like I said before.
But the thing is, brother, an ideology, right, okay, is such a vast concept, right, okay, it's, you know, and it can differ from person to person, okay. So if you think about, like, the ideology of Islam, your interpretation of Islam is going to be different maybe from this gentleman's interpretation.
Yeah,
who's right?
Fine, but
yeah, you know what I mean? So
the basis, but
to me, the sort of basis of this, of the Ummah, of, if you think about it, is we're collective and let's do something progressive. That's good. But if you think of, like, a so-called Al-Qaeda's call of the Ummah, which is slightly different. Okay, does that make sense? Right, okay. I think there was the one about Guantanamo Bay. Was it you, sir? Yeah. I really like that cut, you know. I mean, if you look... what was it you said again? Sorry.
If he was alive today, he'd be there. He'd be in a prison. Like one.
I think. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I think. Well, I think if somebody like Malcolm X was alive today, he'd be treated as a militant. He'd be treated as an extremist. Okay. Okay. He'd be treated as a danger. Okay. He might be in jail in Guantanamo Bay. Okay. He might be in jail in Belmarsh. Okay, the chances are with somebody like Malcolm X's charisma and his organising powers, he would be, unfortunately. But is he a threat? You know, would he be a threat? Now, remember, a lot of them, in my opinion, you know, if you look at, especially in black America in the 1960s, a lot of black people spent time in jail who really questioned what was happening. People like Huey Newton of the Black Panther Party. There's another person called Mumia Abu-Jamal, etc. Right, even if you go back even further, Antonio Gramsci, the Italian Marxist, I mean, his book is called Prison Notes of Antonio Gramsci. I do think that what you call somebody like Brother Malcolm, then there'd be a very strong chance that he'd be watched. Okay, if that makes sense, you know what I mean? Now, I personally think there'd be a very strong chance that he'd actually be in jail as well. I really, really do. And it's not because he's preaching anything. Look at the way that he's represented now. Still a symbol of hatred at times, a symbol of violence. Okay? And that's so I kind of agree with you. And finally, to your question, sir. Okay, brother. Personally, I think that question... And I hope I'm not offending anyone, right? What's your name, sir?
Luke.
I kind of think what Luke is saying is what I feel more affinity with. Okay? Because I don't care if you're Muslim, Hindu, Buddhist, Jew. I don't care. I really, really don't care. Right, okay? You know, and I think if you look at the Holy Quran... And like the way that, you know, it allows you to be as inclusive as possible. But I also think that a lot of religions allow that. Mahatma Gandhi once said, religion is not bad, it's man that makes it bad. And this, again, is dependent upon your intent. I can pick up the Holy Quran or the Holy Bible and I can either enslave people or free people. Does that make sense? You know what I mean? And it depends on your intent. Right, okay, and I really think about yourself. If you're happy, you know, now, all of my adult life, I've tried to understand racism. And I actually think that the reason why people become racist is they have self-doubt amongst themselves for whatever reason. Okay, now, when I meet somebody from anywhere around the world, right, like, is there anyone here from anywhere around the world, not Africa or Asia? Anyone from, I don't know, Lithuania or Ukraine or Estonia? Now, when I meet somebody from there, I don't go, oh my God, you're Ukrainian, go away from me. My first reaction is, what football team do you support? And that's my bridging, you know what I mean? Because, and now, maybe it's just because I'm confident in my own faith, in my own background. But I can understand somebody turning round here, right, and going, oh my God, there's a black man with a headscarf on, said they're back. Because, no, it's not this sister's fault, it's that person's fault. Because he or she hasn't got confidence in him or herself and is reacting with kind of hatred. Now, maybe I'm wrong, right, okay. But I look upon the Holy Quran and I can't see. As you said there, you know what I mean? It allows you to... I can remember a couple of years ago, about 10, 15 years ago, when my sister got married, and she was going to marry a white Scottish person, and we had people turning around going, oh, they've got to marry a Muslim, this is really, really bad, this is terrible, and all that. And then, but if you read the Holy Quran, you have to marry someone of faith. You know, and I remember reading this thing. I mean, the person actually converted to Islam anyway, years later, actually, of his own choice. But to me, that wasn't a threat. You know, I mean, he actually believed in God at the time himself, but somebody who has faith. Now, whatever that faith that means, I don't know. I think it depends on how people, you know.
Maybe as a world, we do need religion. I don't know. Do you need it to be...
Do we need religion?
Because would people...
I don't...
Can people learn?
You're asking me that. You're asking me that.
Philosophy lectures.
Yeah. Do we need? I think it's got its place. I mean, I look at my mum. She prays five times a day. My sisters pray five times a day. Some of my brothers pray five times a day. They go and do zakat. They go out. I don't just mean like every week. They sort of do things, etc. Right? I can remember years ago being in Thailand. This was about 2002. I go to Thailand quite a lot because I really love it there. Okay, I love the food, I love the climate, and I like fighting there. That sounds bad, but I do boxing across there, okay? And that's why I go, so I go there quite a lot. And I can remember somebody asking me, are you a Muslim? This taxi driver. And I was like, I don't know. I was like, I don't know. I don't know. I think that's up to somebody else to judge, you know, if I'm a good person or if I'm not a good person or whatever. And you know something, but sometimes I do get a question myself. When the tsunami happened, because I was distraught, 2005, I was absolutely distraught, you know, and I remember having a big debate with a night.